I just want to say thank you to the panel. We are so happy to have you all here, Ellen and Dorell and Commissioner Annucci. And I just want to say to everyone out there that we are actually Facebook Live, which is a first at the Ford Foundation for a book event. So hello to everyone out there in Facebook land. So let's get started. We were last week at Columbia University for the Just Leadership convening, and the marvelous Vivian Nixon was there and being her marvelous self. And one of the things that came up in the conversation was this notion of we are now moving from a justice orientation more to a law and order orientation. So Ellen, my question to you is, first of all, why did you write this book? And the second question I have for you is, what is the importance of it in this particular context today, right now?
Well, that's two big questions. Why did I write the book? I wrote the book for many, many reasons. But I have to be honest, the first reason was I wanted to have a great book party. And I wanted my grandchildren to come, and Hope, Peter, and Evan are right over there, so we can have a great party. We'll try to keep our remarks short, but it's an important topic, so I guess I shouldn't just go to the party. I really wrote this book, I think, as a result of two quite different experiences. The first was meeting Max Kenner, my first year at Bard, which was more than a decade ago now, or about a decade ago. Max, who has a shoulder that was just operated on, so you can't hug him, you have to be careful, founded the Bard Prison Initiative when he was an undergraduate at Bard. And I met him, and over one cup of coffee, he convinced me to do what I swore I would never again do, which was teach in the summer. And this time it was teach in a prison in the summer. No air conditioning, no open windows, nothing nice, hot, dripping hot, right after lunch. I mean, this guy can talk anybody into doing anything for BPI. So he talked me into this, and it took one cup of coffee to convince me this was something to write, worth writing about and really investing in. So that's the second reason, my grandchildren are the first, that I wrote this book. The third reason has to do with Joe Williams and Tone, a whole bunch of people scattered, or Nico, scattered around this room, who are former students of ours. When I first went on this hot, dripping hot July day that Max convinced me to teach for BPI, and got to the door of my classroom, I'd never been in a prison, and I looked through the glass on the prison door and I thought, what the hell are you doing here? And I really froze. And then this gentleman named Wes Keynes, who is also here somewhere, though I don't see Wes. Where are you, Wes? Back there. Wes came to the door and he opened it and he said, Professor Langemann, we've been waiting for you. At that point, I had no choice. I had to go in. So I went in, I put down my books. I remember worrying about where to put my car keys. And because I guess I thought they'd steal the car. I don't know what I thought. And I started teaching. And before the end of less than 2 hours, I was totally hooked on these students. I mean, the students I've encountered now in 6 different correctional facilities across New York State and in some others that I've visited are among the brightest, most intellectual, most curious, most fun to teach, and eager to learn, and are learning. They're just soaking up and giving back with extraordinary questions and comments. So it's really the students that hooked me, and I want to tell their story. Now, the last thing you asked me was, why is this book important? This book is important because educating people in prison is part of making this country a democracy. We like to think we're a democracy, but we have more than 2 million people in prison who are being deprived of all sorts of rights, including the right to education. And that just is not acceptable. We're protesting all sorts of things at the moment, which we should be protesting, but we also need to protest the situation of prisons that don't offer full education all the way. And I hope my book, in a tiny little way, will contribute to that conversation. The more we can talk about what education does and about the people who have gone through college, the more stories we can tell, and the extraordinary success they've had. I mean, Joe Williams out here, I could go on for hours and hours about Joe Williams. We need to talk about it. So that's the importance.
Can I build on that last statement? So one of the things you mentioned in the book is you quote Derek Bach.
And, probably.
Well, you do.
And, I love Derek Bach.
Right. But one of the things you say about it is you say he talks about the importance of education in terms of not just providing useful knowledge, but also the whole enlightened citizenship.
Right.
And then we all know that you are a student of a colleague of the great Larry Crimmon.
Right.
The great historian, the great educational historian, who really talked about democracy and education, and you have a chapter in your book about that. So can you say a little bit more about building upon, in the context of now, why this is so important?
I would say you can think about democracy in any number of ways. You can think of it as the right to vote. You can think of it as that kind of participation. Or you can think of it in the way John Dewey did, as associated living. Democracy is the way we interact between and among ourselves and with all of ourselves. And we cannot wall off more than 2 million people in prisons and say we are a democracy. Mm-hmm. And democracy is created by education. When you lock people up, you separate them from society, you put incredible pressure on their families, and you take away the right to education, you are taking away the glue of democracy, and we just can't afford to do that. You know, people talk about the economic competitiveness of the United States in the world. That's very important. But our standing as a democracy may be even more important, and we're losing it. So this is one way we can help retrieve it in a little way.
One last question before I move to Dorell. There's a marvelous piece when you talk about families and neighborhoods, also in the book. And many of us, we've read the great book that came out from the National Research Council that Jeremy and Bruce co-chaired.
Right.
And there's a section.
It's that thick if you've read it.
It's a really great book. But two-thirds of the way through, it's a great book, Max.
You can't read it. You have to read in it.
You have to. But two-thirds of the way through the book, they talk about spatial concentrations of high rates of incarceration and its impact on educational attainment, on health, on housing insecurity, on economic insecurity. Say more about the importance of education and its impact on families and neighborhoods, and I'll ask Dorell to build on that.
Well, you know, the story or the factoid I like to talk about the most is the finding that children of people who've been to prison are likely themselves to go to prison. They are significantly more likely to go to prison than people who have not had a parent in prison. And the way to interrupt that cycle is to send people to college while they're in prison. When they come home, and even before they come home, they can then model the importance of being educated and what it takes to go to college and write papers and so on. I remember when Dorell, while he was still inside, used to have phone conversations with his college-age daughter about the papers she was writing, and his papers were longer. But they were having conversations about who was writing the longest, toughest papers. I mean, what a way to transform the experience. And so I think it's a way very much to strengthen families and to interrupt some of the most destructive things that have happened to families as a result of incarceration.
Mm-hmm. So Dorell, welcome to Ford. It's good to see you again.
As
you haven't noticed, all of us are kind of a family here, and all of us in this room, so we're very comfortable talking with each other in a very informal way. So Dorell, the question I have for you is, first of all, how did you find out about BPI? Why did you apply? And what was that process like?
Okay, I found out about BPI the minute I stepped into Easton Correctional Facility. I think it was in 2004. I came from the Clinton Correctional Facility to Easton Correctional Facility on a transfer. And one of my good friends for years was in the program. His name is Solly Israel, who's out now and doing great things at the Bell Fund in Brooklyn. Mm. He was, you know, one of the stars of BPI. We all looked at Solly as such. And he said, you know, they call me Rel, short for Dorell. So he said, Rel, what you gonna do? Mm-hmm. I said, what you mean what I'm going to do? He said, they have a college program here. It's starting up and it's gone. What you going to do? I said, I just brought my bags inside my cell. Like, can I eat first? So if you know Soli, Soli's very persistent, almost equal to Max. And so Soli said, listen, the admissions is coming up and you know, you need to take that. And I almost didn't have a choice. So I went into the admissions. The admissions process was three classrooms filled with candidates. We heard that it was probably about 15 spaces that they would, you know, honor, that they would accept 15 people out of about maybe 100. And I said, oh man, what do you got me in now? But you know, I was there and I, you know, I took the admissions placement test and you know, I was fortunate enough to be accepted. And I was very excited about that. But you know, the real reason why I went into BART, because, you know, why I even applied is because there wasn't nothing left for me to do in my eyes. You know, I had already been in, 10 years on a 20-year bid. Mm-hmm. And I had already completed my mandatory, you know, program, state program, and what they call the assessed needs programs. I don't know if they still refer to it as that, but there's an assessment when you come in and, you know, you are assessed based on your crime and activities on the outside or what they feel you may need on the inside to, you know, contribute to your rehabilitation. So I had completed all of that, Doug, and at that point there was, you know, your own, you know, self-teaching and other programs that a lot of the, you know, persons incarcerated teach themselves, a lot of cultural programs, but there was nothing there that, you know, spoke loud as college education. Mm-hmm. The opportunity to have a college education. And so I jumped at it. And you spoke about the impact on families. I don't know if I'm getting ahead of you or anything, but.
Oh, you can go with whatever you just keep going.
You know, I don't want to get ahead on you, but I was excited to call my daughter and mom and be able to say, look, I'm getting ready to apply for college. Uh-huh. And you know, they were just blown away. Like, what, are you serious? Like, and I said, I'm going to apply for college. And so, you know, your mom always says, well, you should have been in college anyway. You shouldn't be in the damn jail anyway. So, you know, you can't respond to that. And I applied, and my daughter was elated. She wrote me this like fantastic letter of how proud she was. Mm-hmm. And
can I tell the story about tuition?
Yeah, sure. I'll let Ellen tell you.
Dorell managed to save $1,000 on prison wages,
and then
which
I'll
are
tell
not
you
high.
And then I'll tell you a story about her now and
okay.
What
okay,
she wants
let me
from
start. So he managed to save $1,000 working in the laundry and the barbershop to help pay his daughter's college tuition.
Where's Witter? Where's Vaughn? Where's Vaughn? Is Vaughn? Yeah.
What? Yes, he's right there.
He was one of my contracted laundry people. Sorry, Commissioner, it was just you.
Ain't gotta eat, man.
Right. So that was, you know, it. I was excited to be able to share that I was going to apply. When I got in, when I received my acceptance letter, I copied maybe about 50 copies in the law library, and I sent them to everybody that I knew, and everybody was just so happy for me. I got some visits out of that one.
That's great. That's great. That's fantastic. So I have to ask you another question. This has come up a lot, and we talk about it a lot here at mm-hmm. Ford and among our colleagues and partners, and that is... I went to a graduation ceremony at Sing Sing. We have the great mm-hmm. Sean Pika here and his wife. And, you know, it's interesting because that was when Warren Buffett was giving the commencement address, and Doris Buffett was there, and I never knew that the first time I'd have, any time I'd have dinner with Warren, Doris would be in the maximum security prison. But it was interesting, and it was great, you know, and we had a wonderful conversation, you know, with them. But what the conversation that was the best, the speech that was the best, was a valedictorian that year. Mm-hmm. Because a valedictorian talked about, you know, you will see me, you know, in my church, you will see me at a board meeting, you will see me at a PTA meeting, you will see me chairing meetings, you will see me at board meetings. You will see me other than what you're seeing me doing or being in prison. So my question is, there are these dominant cultural narratives that exist out there. Mm-hmm. And we are constantly trying to combat those dominant cultural mm-hmm. narratives. Can you say more about that? Say a little bit more about how we can combat dominant cultural narratives that people, and certain assumptions people have if they've been justice involved, or if they have a criminal record, or if they've been in prison.
You mean the individual, mm-hmm. the person, how does the person combat
Well, that? All of us, just in terms of how do we combat dominant cultural narratives, and also the individual as well?
I'll first start with the individual, and then maybe I'll get an answer for outside of the individual. Only because when I came home, within the first year of being home, I got a job with the Brooklyn Defender Services, which is the public defender's office in Brooklyn. And I was on the criminal justice social work team for the adolescents unit. I work with Joe and my old supervisors here, Ron Schneider, who's the supervisor of the social work unit in Brooklyn Defenders. And so in representing a lot of young males inside criminal and Supreme Court, you know, who had just arrests. And because of the arrests and the stigma that, you know, is associated with the arrests, so many of these young males felt like, you know, it was over for them.
Yeah.
You know, and I'm talking about 15, 16, and 17-year-olds. And mind you, I went, you know, to jail when I was 16 years old. So, you know, and you have parents who I've, you know, talked with and counseled and, you know, who are obviously concerned about, you know, their child and his or her development and future. And, you know, I would just sometimes, a lot of times, disclose, you know, right up, because I needed to make that connection in order to dispel that stigma. Mm. I needed to make the connection immediately, because a lot of times that conversation can just be recognized as talk, right? You know, that's why we're even raising a question, because it just floats as talk so much. But, you know, here I am, an individual who went to jail at 16, who benefited from college programs at the bachelor's and the master's level, and then who returned home, and now my colleagues are criminal defense attorneys and criminal defense social workers. So that's mind-blowing.
Yes.
Inside the court that convicted me for 20 years.
Right.
So, you know, the irony there, I mean, I just laid it out just like that to a lot of folks. And I tell them, like, it doesn't always have to be college education. I said, but find something that you think you're interested in. Because I have a lot of friends who, like, you know, they have vocational education. And they do well. They come home and, you know, they start in their own, you know, different industries they're involved in. And it's a passion for them, so it's not work, you know? But to be more pointed, Doug, I think it really starts from inside. Like, you really have to believe. But sometimes that belief is ignited through opportunity, mm-hmm. right? So, you know, you can feel like you can do certain things, but sometimes you're just so locked out of the opportunity to do certain things that it becomes frustrating. And I've seen this in a lot of our young people who were in the criminal justice system when I was at Brooklyn Defender Services. And, you know, it was a difficult job for me because it's mm-hmm. trying to instill hope, right? One of the hardest things in certain mm-hmm. circumstances to do. But we have some folks who did it,
right?
And when you see one, and you see two, and then you start seeing three, and you start researching and you start making connections and associations, then the myth starts to dispel itself for those of us who are, you know, educated and aware to recognize it. And if we can move some of our biases out the way and just look and accept some things for what they are, and, you know, that's the way we dispel that stigma. And that's the way we encourage people and give them that, you know, extra push they need. And that's what happened to me. And, you know, I took myself out, and I've done it for countless young people.
You know, one of the things that we've learned a lot from Glenn Martin and Just Leadership, who, by the way, Rikers, amazing work. Yes. Amazing, amazing work. And that is that, you know, we should be supporting, both in philanthropy, but also all of us should be supporting individuals who have been most impacted to be the voice of this movement, so that we can support them in changing the dominant, what may be the dominant cultural narrative in many ways. So really appreciate him really teaching all of us, and you and everybody else who have been incarcerated, teaching us that lesson.
Definitely.
So, Commissioner, good to have you here tonight.
Thank you. Good to be here.
You know, we share something in common. We've both worked for a governor, and I am a recovering policymaker. So,
let me know how rehab works.
I will. Can I just say publicly, you have been an incredible partner in this work. Just incredible. Thank you. Absolutely marvelous. You've been a visionary. You've worked really hard to ensure that these high-quality programs are in New York State prisons. So my question to you is, why should corrections be involved in this work? And what would you say to others that are in your position nationally?
Let me start with what may have been the most successful ad campaign to raise money for education. Everybody's familiar with it. It's the commercials that ended with a voice saying, a mind is a terrible thing to waste. And that is true today, more so than ever. Wherever the mind is, whether it's behind the walls, in the community, in a poor, rich neighborhood, wherever that mind may be, it needs to be educated. All of us are born into this world as blank slates. How far we go, what journeys we take, are completely dependent upon the educational opportunities we are afforded. In my personal life, I was very fortunate because my parents gave me the means to go to school, and I have a law degree and a graduate degree and an undergraduate degree. But I was talking with Joe Williams, and he was at a school that was right around the block from me. Right? He was, for a period of time, at McKinley. I went to school across the street at St. Ephraim's, but it just reminded me, and I think about this often when I look inside our classrooms, inside our facilities, how many of these young men and women would never have been there if they just had a few opportunities earlier on in life, if they just had that mentor to be the hand on their shoulder to say, don't go with the gang, study instead, education is everything, don't pick up the gun, whatever mistake they made. I had those opportunities, but I see these individuals later on incarcerated, that they are eager to learn, they're appreciative of the opportunity, and it's not too late to learn once you're inside a correctional facility. And I think every single correctional administrator in the country, if asked this question, who do you want to be a role model for the rest of the inmate population, the gang leader or the classroom leader? And they will say, the classroom leader. The students inside our facilities are role models for everybody else. It's like a multiplier effect. Instead of hanging out in the yard, they are working very hard under sometimes some pretty stark circumstances. People compare college to college on the outside. It's a world of difference. When you get the college experience on a fancy campus, you have beautiful campuses and lawns and statues and big libraries and computers, and you have all the social life that goes with that, and fraternities and homecoming parades and everything else. You have none of that. You have basically the stark prison, but you have the essence of what education is. You have the anxious student who's willing to learn, and you have the willing professor, the willing teacher, to give them that education. And it is a beautiful thing. And before I say anything else, I want to say, first and foremost, thank you to the Ford Foundation. Mm-hmm. Thank you to every individual that contributes so that higher education is back in our correctional facilities where it belongs. As commissioner, I appreciate that so much. Mm.
Thank you very much. So this is a question I have for all of you. Is this a question of what's next? You know, there's an emerging college for all movement in the country right now. There are a lot of debates about free college and how that should be constructed. And so there are issues that come up about that. So I want to get your opinions about it. Obviously, Governor Cuomo has put forth a proposal. How does this play into the conversations we've been talking about in terms of the need for high-quality programming in correctional facilities? Your thoughts on that?
Go first.
Well, as I argue in my book, I think the College for All movement, as it is actualized, which I think will happen slowly but surely, first in different states and hopefully across the nation, takes away what has been the standard argument against college and prison, which is what I call the fairness argument. It's not fair to let these, bums who've been convicted of crimes go to college free when people outside are struggling to pay tuition. And that's a serious argument. And it's got to be refuted on the way to getting more and more public support for college and prison. And I think College for All helps to do that. It helps to make it, you know, everybody in a democracy needs education, and all has got to be all. There are no people who should be by category excluded. So that's a first step, and others may have other thoughts.
No, I echo those sentiments, and when I speak at a graduation, I remind everybody of the importance of education to our society, to our civilization. All of civilization and humanity advance throughout the eras because knowledge, wisdom, and understanding are acquired, preserved, and then made available for generations that have not yet been born. Mm. So whatever we do to make education as available as possible for everyone, we advance as a society. We ensure that we will leave the world a better place for the next generation.
Yeah. What did you want to say anything, Dorell, on that?
No.
Okay. One of the things we're going to, you know, I'm a former middle school teacher, so I keep, I'm a taskmaster when it comes to this.
Right.
So we're going to open
up
the questions in just a minute. But one of the things I wanted to mention that is so interesting just for me is that we always see these kinds of pieces on the criminal justice continuum as separate from each other. So think about schooling, policing, sentencing, time in prison, pre-release, moment of release, post-release, and all the issues related to that when it comes to reentry supports, access to employment, access to housing, access to transportation, access to health care, and all those kinds of things that mitigate against criminogenic risk factors. So I think it's important when we think about education that we also link it with how it's all sort of connected across that continuum, and so it's not so separated. And so people understand that one of the reasons why we have lower recidivism for high quality programs is because of the fact that they have access to these kinds of opportunities, right? And so they're
Absolutely.
All sort of linked. And I think it's important for us to think about it that way. I used to go to a lot of criminal justice forums and, you know, no one would ever mention the word education. Or you would be in an education forum and no one would mention about individuals who are justice involved who could possibly be, you know, have the opportunity to be educated. So I do think that we have to think about it in a much more connective and thoughtful way. I'm getting off my soapbox here for a minute. So we have the mics, and so if you have a question for any of us, please come up to the mics and ask us a question.
Rolling
and
back.
For those of you out in Facebook world, we will also be able to You can also generate questions as well. So come up to the mic. Identify yourself first, like Vivian needs identification, but identify yourselves first and ask your question.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
First, I have a comment, and Doug, of course, an excellent job moderating, but my compliments to you, Ellen, for the work that you've been doing all these years and for the publication of the book.
Thank you.
And I'm just so proud to be a New Yorker. Because New York really has been at the forefront since Pell Grants were made unavailable to students in prison. New York has been at the forefront of making sure that through other means, education remained in the prisons. I really had admired former Commissioner Fisher for his commitment to this. And Commissioner Annucci, thank you for continuing that legacy. We are deeply grateful. My name is Vivian Nixon. I'm Executive Director of College and Community Fellowship. And our concern is creating bridge programs so people who may get a chance to attend the Bard Prison Initiative or the Hudson Link Program or the Marymount Program at Bedford get out and they don't have a degree, who is there in the reentry sphere to make sure that they make those adequate connections to education on the inside. And I'm wondering if you would comment on that. That's the work I've been doing for 17 years and have gotten support from the Department of Corrections, thank you, support from Ford and from others. But I think it's important for us to have that conversation, right? Because everybody is not gonna acquire a degree while incarcerated, but may come out with a desire to complete a degree or start a degree. So can we talk about bridge programs for a minute? Thank you so much.
Thanks, Vivian. Thoughts on that?
Well, you know, we have somebody here, Jed Tucker, who actually, he's going to kill me. he runs our reentry program, and he took it from scratch to something that's really quite robust. And it begins post-college degree in prison with some classes and courses, and then works into jobs and graduate school and so on. And I think it's part of the seamlessness you're talking about. We desperately need good reentry work of the kind you're doing, Vivian. I mean, college alone is not enough. There's no one panacea for problems as big as the criminal justice problem.
Yeah, and I echo that, and I think it's very important. I think we're definitely moving in the right direction with the new expansions that are on the horizon with our new funding source from the Manhattan District Attorney's Office, asset forfeiture. I know in conversations with certain institutions, they're not only concerned about providing the additional programs behind the walls, but continuing that on their campuses when individuals get out. And I think we've made a lot of progress into removing the barriers so that people aren't stigmatized by the fact that they may have a prior record. And I know that there's a lot of open-mindedness with people that run the higher education institutions. We bring students from outside, side by side, inside with our students, so they can be exposed and realize that these are not the dangerous offenders that you may have seen when they were first arrested. These are students just like you. They're going to come out just like you. They're not dangerous. They have done bad things, but they are not bad people. They are capable of changing their lives and turning that around. And the more we can put a human face on people, and that's what Ellen did in her book, and that's what all our graduates are doing, the more we will get society to understand that this is in all of our best interests to have higher education behind the walls and accept them when they come out and continue that.
And I would be remiss if I didn't thank you, Vivian, about reminding us about Second Chance. So, and I know you were at the forefront of that along with many people in this room, but we have such a great opportunity when it comes to that program. If you think about the fact that over 200 colleges and universities applied to that program representing 48 states, the vast majority in Texas. They were red, blue, green, yellow. They were all kinds, right? There were 69 colleges and universities funded representing 28 states. But the other beauty of it is the fact that there was a large conversation about not only the in-prison degree portion of it, but also what do you do in terms of the reentry supports when people come out. So when we think about it, they have to go hand in hand, like a hand in a glove. Yes, sir.
Hi, my name is Brian Lewis. I work for an organization that works with young people who are criminally justice involved. It's called Exalt Youth. It's based in downtown Brooklyn. So my question is, you know, you alluded to the exciting criminal justice system reforms that are happening. Obviously, you know, college and prison is an important one. We have a movement now to close Rikers. We have Raise the Age legislation finally included in the budget. My question is, what is the next step for criminal justice reform? And how do we get the young people specifically, because I work with an organization that works with teenagers, and they have a lot of passion and ideas, and Dorell, you know, alluded to this as well. They have a lot of passion and ideas for how we can make those reforms. But how do we get the young people and the people who are incarcerated and the people who are most impacted by these issues to play an even bigger role now that the mayor and, you know, the state and other folks are finally starting to, you know, move this issue?
I could start.
Commissioner?
Yesterday, I was at a really uplifting event. It was at Sing Sing Correctional Facility, and it's become a movement. It basically started with about 11 different individuals who are in prison for serious crimes, but who are very much remorseful about what they have done. And we have youth assistance program where we bring youth into our facilities, and these men talk to them. They don't scare them. They basically honestly talk to them about the importance of making the proper choices. The wrong choices have incredible consequences. And I said to the superintendent years ago, I said, these men have a profound message that needs to be heard beyond the youth that we're bringing to our correctional facilities. We need to record that message and get it out there. And eventually we had a producer from NBC come in with equipment, volunteer. We set up the camera so that these individuals looked into the camera and spoke from the heart and talked to the camera as if they were talking to a younger version of themselves. It's a 7-minute clip. It's called Voices from Within. You can see it on YouTube, but it's a very profound message. The police department uses it. Probation officers use it. We use it throughout our youth assistance program. My point being that there are men in prison there for a long time whose message could be very profound while they're behind the walls and what they get released. So I am looking to expand that as best I can. This might become a documentary in a couple of years. The more we can guide young people into making the right choices, the better off we will be, the more we will shrink our criminal justice system, which is incredibly costly. But we are moving in the right direction in New York State. We went from 72,600 inmates to where we are today, 51,300, and the decline is still going. So that is significant progress.
Any other comments on that? I'm going to take one more question, but I want to just comment one thing on that. So as a program officer in our Youth Opportunity and Learning division here at Ford, what's been so interesting is to see so many young people where mass incarceration and criminal justice reform is at the very top of their concerns and their issues. Had the great opportunity a couple weeks ago to talk to 500 young people. We had a couple of their leaders here yesterday for lunch. So I think we have to figure out ways to invest and connect all of these young people who are out there who are desperate to try to make a difference in this. And I'm so happy that you put that in front of us for further conversation. One more question over here.
Yes. Good evening, everyone. So I'm Joe Williams. I'm just the average Joe.
Oh, no.
I know you all have heard a lot about me so far. So I am currently employed at DeVita Dialysis Center. I'm a renal social worker. I also work for Henry Street Settlement, where I work in a high school. And I conduct one-on-one counseling with high school youth. And I teach a young men's empowerment group. As of late, I taught all my guys how to play chess, and they love it. And my third job is I am a social worker part-time or per diem with Mount Sinai in the psychiatric emergency room. And I'm also formerly incarcerated.
Husband and a father, don't forget that.
Two children.
Husband and a father,
and a Columbia graduate with my master's in social work, and I'm also licensed in New York State as a licensed master's social worker. All right. I segue that, or I like to start off with that, is as a see me now, and then let's take a trip into memory lane as who I was. My question really is for you, Commissioner Annucci, and I recognize that when I went through Bard College, the superintendent that was in place was somewhat pro-programming and pro the Bard College Prison Initiative. On the ground level, what I hear from a lot of guys that's still incarcerated is they face antagonism for those who are pursuing higher education. So from a administrative perspective and position, what are you telling your administration to bolster and boost participation in higher education, as well as letting your staff know that this is something to be lauded and not something to be punished?
There are a lot of things we're doing, Joe. First of all, my own personal actions, what I do, sets the tone, right? So I set the example, and I make it a point wherever I can to go to the graduations and speak. So they hear my words directly of the importance of education, how appreciative I am that it's back in our institutions, and I congratulate the men. I tell them how great this is that they've accomplished. I remind them that this is a milestone, that education is a lifelong pursuit. I have my deputy commissioner here for programs and my assistant commissioner. They're here because they support and know from me how important college education is. This is a process, right? And there are security issues, and some people are a little old school, but basically, I welcome all of the professors that come in. They have the official status of volunteers, which means they are like unpaid employees. And so we want to ensure that education is delivered, that we can accommodate, and we work things out. And if something comes to my level, then it comes to my level, and I will take appropriate action. But I send the strongest possible message by my own words, by my presence, that college education is very, very important. Another thing, which is I believe is being supported by the Ford Foundation, the only way to change the whole conversation in this country is to show them firsthand what's going on. Mm-hmm. So I've opened the doors for Florentine Films, which is a Ken Burns project. And we know when he does a documentary, he does a very good documentary. They've been filming for several years now. I've given them very broad access. And I'm very confident that when the final product is produced, it's really going to cause this entire country to really sit back and think about this, because they're going to see firsthand what it's like, what education is like. They're going to follow the journey of these men through the classrooms, what it's like to study inside a cell, what it's like when they get released, what are the hurdles they have to overcome. It's going to be a thorough story. I am confident in that. And that's why I opened our cell doors, in effect, for them to come in to film so that we can have the next discussion in this country about the importance of college education, not just for the incarcerated, for everybody. Yeah. And our governor has made that commitment front and center, and I think it's part of the national conversation because it is so important for everybody. Yeah. And I hope that conversation continues.
Well, thank you, and we look forward to screening that film. Happy that it's supported by our Just Films documentary unit and our education unit and Hillary's division. So we look forward to seeing all you back for that when it comes out.